friends. Welcome to episode 54 of School Librarians United. I am your host, Amy Herman. This podcast is dedicated to the issues and challenges school librarians face every day. As a school librarian in my 13th year, I found myself asking the question, where is the podcast that will help me do my job? I wanted a podcast which addressed the nuts and bolts of running a successful library program. I don't claim to have the answers, but I hope that this is a platform to share resources and exchange ideas. Now is a perfect time to mention that all the ideas and opinions expressed in this podcast by myself and my interview guests are our own and do not reflect those of our school districts. When incorporating research, I always make sure to cite my sources. So whether you are a novice or a veteran school librarian, this podcast has something for you. Hello, and thank you very much for tuning in to the very last episode of this decade. I can honestly say that I now host a weekly podcast for school librarians, and after 16 straight weeks of recording, I will be taking my very first break to enjoy the holidays with my family. I will resume my weekly schedule in January 2020. I have lots of irons in the fire, so to speak, and lots of interesting interviews and topics lined up for everyone. I'd like to extend a very special welcome this week to listeners Tina in New York, who reached out to the podcast. She wrote, quote, I am in my third year as a library media specialist, and each day feels like the first. Your podcast has been a lifesaver. Michelle, also from New York, gave me something of a present for podcasters. I always encourage listeners to contact me with episode suggestions. Well, this week, Michelle reached out to the podcast via email and said, quote, I couldn't find any podcast episodes about English as a new language and how libraries can be best prepared to meet the needs of English language learners. I'm wondering if you ever did one on this topic. If not, is it something you might consider? And I answered Michelle by saying that I was waiting for somebody to offer. Michelle's episode is one of many you can look forward to in early 2020. I welcome you and all listeners to reach out with your feedback and episode suggestions either on Facebook, Twitter, or the email address schoollibrariansunited@gmail.com. If you include your mailing address, I will be sure to send you a podcast sticker. If you haven't heard episode 40, which was posted on September 8th, advocating for LGBTQ+ and all students, and my interview with Joanne Boudreau, I highly recommend it. Joanne and I discuss many related topics, including sponsoring a GSA, collection development, and EduPride Alliance. Be sure to check out all the resources in the show notes. I also included links to 4 great podcast episodes on LGBTQ+ literature for kids of all ages. And now, for today's episode, creating a safe space for LGBTQ+ students and my interview with Kelly Boston. I am so excited to be sharing this conversation with you. I am fortunate to have found somebody like Kelly. Her candor and her sincerity are evident, and she is very generous in sharing her story and her experiences. And she and I realized that just because there's a chance a conversation might become awkward doesn't mean it shouldn't happen. Quite the opposite, really. This interview gave me so much to consider and reflect upon. I hope you feel the same way. And now, my interview with Kelly Boston. You been a school librarian, and a little bit about your journey. Most of us aren't this isn't the thing we started off doing right off the bat.
Right, absolutely. So I actually had kind of a weird journey to get there. My first job ever when I was 16 was as a page in my local public library. So I grew up, when I was growing up, we didn't have a lot of money, but my mom always made it a priority to take me to the library every week, and we'd go to story times and programming, and it just was my happy place. So that made sense to me to start working there. I worked my way up to being a clerk at the front desk, and then in college, I ended up working at the Zumberg Library at Grand Valley. So I ended up getting my degree in English and French. I moved to France for a year and taught. I was a language assistant in a French high school. I moved to LA and my teaching certificate didn't transfer. I worked for an airline for a couple of years and then I moved back. I saw a librarian position And I applied for it, and I did a Skype interview, and I got it and moved back to Michigan, and then I finished getting my master's. So.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah. I love that you have your beginnings. You loved the library as a child, and I wish I could say I have those same stories. I think we all have ones that lead us where we land, but that's very sweet. Can you tell me about your current program, where you are right now, and what's a typical day for you?
Yeah, so I teach at Wayland Union Schools. So I am split between two buildings, and we've changed grades around a little bit in the last year. So now I'm at a fourth and fifth grade building 2 days a week, and then I'm at a sixth, seventh, and eighth grade building 3 days a week.
So wow, I just have to say, the collections would be subtle. The difference, it's in the same district, but because your age groups are slightly different, I imagine the collections would be slightly different as well, or the emphasis of the collections would be slightly different.
Yes, it's funny to see which things work for both. Like, everybody loves Dog Man, Diary of a Wimpy Kid, and all that stuff.
But it's like a Venn diagram. You have a Venn diagram of your purchasing, what you're going to purchase for both, and then you have to have your separate purchases. I purchase for two buildings as well, but they're both elementary. And the only reason why they're different is because different librarians covered them before me. So I end up filling gaps where I you know, in some buildings and building up other parts of the collection in others. Can you tell me a little bit about your day? Are you fixed? You're flexible? What kind of programmings do you offer to your teachers and your students?
Yeah, so if I'm at the elementary school, I teach, we do a special. It's a media special up through fifth grade. So I teach the media classes on Monday, Tuesday. And then in the afternoons, I'm a little more flexibly scheduled and can work with teachers and things. And then Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, I'm flexibly scheduled at the middle school. So we're one-to-one with iPads currently. So I do a lot of implementing things on the iPads and apps and going into the classroom. There's a lot of Flipgrid going on today. But yeah, I'm planning with teachers. I just completed a graduate course in incorporating more STEM programming in school libraries.
Sure.
Which I would highly recommend. So I just finished that, so I'm working on incorporating more of that in my programming. But we're kind of in, you know, those survival years where everything changes and you're just kind of flying by the seat of your pants trying to get through. So
yes.
Yeah.
I think
one of those.
I think that there's a flexibility is something that is expected of us because we are oftentimes subject to a great deal of influences outside of our program, and we just have to be incredibly flexible. I know we're closing two schools, and we'll be consolidating collections and moving students and moving grade levels. So our fifth graders will be moving to the middle school. So we are sort of trying to anticipate how that's going to impact our collection, as well as our programming, what kind of classes we offer, because we teach a special. And now that they're going to the middle school, you know, we're trying desperately to make sure that those classes are still offered to our fifth graders. Well, I'll tell you, I mentioned earlier, I attended your presentation at our state conference, Queer Eye for the Library, supporting LGBTQ+ populations in the school library. And listeners, I'm going to include Kelly's presentation in our show notes. I strongly recommend that you not only take a look at it, but really take a look at it, because there is so much information in there. And this is I did a great deal of reflection when I was going through each of those slides, because you really do ask yourself, what am I doing and what do I need to change about how I support all of my students? So when you presented this at our conference, Kelly, in October, the room was packed, absolutely packed. And I think that's very telling. As somebody who presented at the same conference and did not present to a packed room, I'm trying not to be jealous. But the attendees were absolutely riveted, and you had the entire audience really completely at paying attention. And all I could think to myself was that this information in this presentation needs to be conveyed not just to school librarians, but to everybody who works with students, whether it's in the classroom or the library setting. And we all know it's not.
That's true. I do feel that I should probably give a little backstory to that. So I have horrible stage fright, but for some reason I keep making myself present at things.
It's not apparent. I promise you it's not apparent.
Oh, I was nervous before this. But I had told myself earlier this year that I wasn't going to do any more presentations that weren't something I really wanted to talk about and was really passionate about. So it was one of those like shower ideas in the morning. I was like, I wonder if MAME would let me present on like how to support queer kids in the library. And a little backstory for people that don't know me, I identify as bisexual and I'm married to a woman, which is part of why that was such a nerve-wracking presentation for me, because I had never presented on something that was so vulnerable for me, especially because there are no legal protections in the state of Michigan right now for gay people or queer people. So it was the first time I'd ever really like stood up in front of a crowd of educators and come out to them. And I think that that's really important because we're out there. There are LGBTQ educators, but I think it's really scary to come out because you're worried about risking your job or angry parents or things like that. And I think that's something I still struggle with even now, whether I should come out to my kids or not, because I know that there are LGBTQ kids in my school, and how valuable would that be for them to see me as an out person who made it through middle school and high school and is okay and is living a happy life and a happy marriage, and but also weighing that with the risks that are involved as well. So
I'm going to just selfishly say thank you again for being on this podcast, because, you know, truly, I think that there are a lot of librarians who are genuinely wanting to support not just our students, but our fellow educators. And I can guarantee you that we all work in districts with teachers who are queer, staff who are queer. And, you know, the idea is that, how we support one another really is valuable, because we want to make sure that our students know that they will be able to, you know, become the wonderfully, you know, happy and productive people as adults. And if they have role models, that is something that really does give them the kind of courage to be themselves. And I think that there are many students who are, some are fortunate to live in loving and supportive families. And I think that, and we're going to talk about this a little later, about students who are not out. And a large part of that has to do with their concerns about how supportive their family members will be. So I agree. And I appreciate, on behalf of the listening audience, I can assure you that you've chosen a platform and you're amongst friends here. So I've learned enough about the listeners of this podcast to know that the message you are providing is one that will be, will give all of us a great deal of reflection. And I think knowing the ultimate goal is that we want to support our students and our staff members we work with, and make sure that everybody can feel encouraged in these learning environments. I did want to mention, and especially friends, when you read this presentation that Kelly put together, your very first slide, we haven't even started, and you said, "Thank you for coming. This is a safe space to learn and to ask questions without judgment. I expect respect from the audience as well." And I really, you know, I'm going to ask you a lot of questions because I'm trying to be a better person, because I recognize not enough is being done to support our LGBTQ+ students. Can you tell us a little bit about what went into your thinking when you wrote that opening slide?
I think that a lot of people get frozen up because they get so afraid of making a mistake or sounding ignorant or offending someone. And I also know, just within the queer community, I have friends and acquaintances who sometimes get really offended with things that straight or cis or both people say. And I think that it's important to me to be an advocate, and I will call people out if they say something that's offensive, but I also think it's okay to make mistakes because that's how you learn. And if you're too afraid to have those conversations, then you're not going to learn. And if you've never been around people who are queer, at least that you're not aware of, or you've never spent time in that community, you just don't know these things. And that's, I don't think it's fair to expect people to know them, but I think it's fantastic that the people in the audience came to seek those answers and be better. Because in the presentation too, one of my favorite quotes is, do the best you can until you know better and then do better. And that's, I do that too. I'm not perfect. And I want to preface this whole thing too. I'm a cis female, and I am not speaking for trans people or intersex people. I can translate what I've learned, but I don't ever want to presume that I know their experience. So,
well, and I think that the fact that you are sharing your own experiences really does speak volumes. And I think all of us can remember when we have embarrassed ourselves or misspoke. And I think the fact is, I don't think we are all equipped with the sensitivities that we need to have necessarily, given many of us grow up, not having this kind of exposure. I'm very fortunate because I was raised in an incredibly open, and I'm Episcopalian, and Episcopalians love everybody, and we don't tend to have some of the opinions that might be held by other other individuals. But I will come right out and say, as a child of the 80s, I made a horrible gaffe my freshman year of college. And truly, it didn't even come from a place of it just was ignorance more than anything. But I remember growing up as a kid in the 80s, and the phrase, "That's so gay," was commonly said. And I remember, and it wasn't, and it meant, unfortunately, it really was just something that people used to say, "Oh, that's so gay." And I still remember the shame I felt when my TA, my teaching assistant, my freshman year in college at the University of Michigan, must have, I don't know, overheard me, or I was in a discussion group, and I must have come out of my mouth. And I was corrected right then and there. And I still to this day have never forgotten just how horrible I felt, because I didn't equate the two. I didn't put the two together that what I said would offend somebody else. And there I get to relive it all over again and remind us just how important our words are when we are talking to people, whether we are aware of an individual's orientation. And this leads me to my next question. Could you explain, and because I've never heard the phrase gender expression, could you explain to me the importance of gender expression?
Absolutely. I did want to make a point to what you were saying just now, too, that yes. I think it's hard because I think people oftentimes equate intention with harm. And sometimes things that we say are not intended to be harmful, but they are because we don't know better. And that there's this really fine line. And I think that that's really tricky because you learned a lesson from that experience that you had.
Yes.
Absolutely. But I also don't want you to hold on to shame for it for the rest of your life. You know okay. what I mean?
I do appreciate that. I'm hopefully mending. I'm, this is a little penance that we've got here, because I do like to use this podcast to raise up messages I think we all should hear. So, round two, this is our second episode on supporting, LGBTQ+. And so, I feel, because this is such a positive and important message, that we spend this time together talking about it. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Going on with that. So gender expression. So I kind of want to just open up with what I talked about during the presentation, was that their gender and sex are two different things. So I really struggle with gender reveal parties, I mentioned in the presentation, because when babies are born, we look at their genitalia and we decide, we sort them into two categories typically in our society. So you're a boy if you have a penis and you're a girl if you have a vagina. And there's not really a whole lot of room in between. And typically, and at my presentation, I asked people kind of what kinds of things do you see for female gender things or male? And, you know, blue is for boys, pink's for girls, girls get fluffy things, boys get footballs and guns and whatever. And those can be really damaging in and of themselves. But there's a whole population of people who don't fit into either one of those categories, into that binary, as we call it. So that can be incredibly damaging. And sometimes if you are corrected by a queer person or a non-binary person, they are dealing with microaggressions all the time. So they may respond to you in a way that feels harsh. I just would advise people to not make it about you. It's not about you. They're dealing with this on a very regular basis. Sure. I think that, and even like bathrooms, we gender, like men go in this bathroom, women go in this bathroom. And if you think about, if you're a person who like inside, you don't necessarily feel like you're male or you're female, where do you fit? And I think that can be very wearing on people. So with the gender identity piece, your gender identity is how you identify inside. So some people identify as male, some people identify as female. If what you identify as matches what you were assigned at birth. So if you're assigned female at birth and you feel like you're female inside, like I do, I would be a cis female. If I did not, then I might be transgender. So that's just a little explanation there. So I think with schools, we see these gender binaries really getting enforced a lot with bathrooms, with locker rooms, with ladies and gentlemen, with dividing classes up by boys and girls, things like
teams,
that.
Teams, so, yes. Teams, yeah. At gym class, yes.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. So if you can imagine, if you're the kid that inside either, we also have an intersex population. So intersex are people who are, you could possibly be born with a combination of male and female genitalia. Sometimes you could be born with a vagina and actually have internal testes, or things like that. There's also combinations with chromosomes, and science is finding more and more combinations all the time. So if you're a kid who doesn't feel like you fit into either one of those things and you're constantly being sorted into a box you don't feel like you fit in, that can be really damaging. And that's part of the reason, there's a lot of reasons why we have so many mental health issues with kids, because they're not feeling accepted for who they are, because they're afraid to come to terms with this. So I do have some tips, and I know we're going to talk about that a little later too.
Yeah.
But a big one, I think, is don't assume that you know someone's gender by what they look like. And so I think as we walk down the street, we tend to just like sort people into different categories. And I've done this. I really had to reteach myself as I was learning more about this. And so an easy way to do that, if you're not sure, is to use the singular they. So, for example, we do this all the time. Like you might say, oh, somebody left their book in here. You don't mean like a group of people left their book in here. You mean a singular person. But that way it's not gendered. So you're not making an assumption. You're not putting that kid into a box that they don't necessarily fit in. Yeah. That's one big tip.
I know I've moved away from, one of my students said, why do you call us friends? And I said, well, I'm not going to call you ladies and gentlemen because you are children. And I'm not going to call you boys and girls because I think that that is rather limiting. And elementary students aren't going to challenge you when you say something like that's limiting. But if I call you friends, all of a sudden I'm not assuming the binary. And so by referring you as friends, hey, friends, that is a far more inclusive way to make sure that anybody's not feeling left out. But right now, when you mention it, I'm thinking when I don't have a seating chart for the computer lab, oftentimes we have a few computer labs that are still intact. I know that they're sort of going away, but I'll simply say, hey, boy, girl, or girl, boy, you pick, I don't care. And now that I think about that, that really could, and you mentioned microaggressions, because I am never reminded of, I can go an entire day and really not have to think about my gender. But if you don't fit neatly into one camp or the other, you might find yourself being like, it's a barrage. And I'm thinking about a few of my students for whom, like you said, don't assume that you can identify what a child themselves identifies as. Because I do have some students for whom I'm meeting for the first time, and I blow it. I completely blow it with I might refer to somebody with a she pronoun or a he pronoun, and it can be completely wrong. So I did want to, you're absolutely right. I did want to mention, and because I really did like what you said early in your presentation. You said, quote, as allies, understand that identities can shift over time, and it's not your place to tell somebody what theirs is. And, you know, I know you've talked a little bit about this, but it is very tricky. I think that teachers want just to be supportive and encouraging our students, and we might make a mistake, especially because their appearance, they may present as one gender and embrace another.
Sorry, can you remind me of the question?
No. They are. It's very, you know, I think that we're blending some of our responses because I think this conversation is one that really, you know, I'm coming at it from a place of ignorance. And I really, really, I told you ahead of time when we were going to have this conversation that you're going to be the expert and I'm going to be the idiot. but I do think that as adults, we tend to make assumptions about our children's identity. And just by appearances, I'm going to look at you, I'm going to see how you dress, and I will make some assumptions based on how you present. And yet you may very well not feel that way at all. And, you know, I think that that's something that we need to remind ourselves. How about we take a look at this idea of being an ally? To the extent that I have tried to support my students are elementary age. When I think I'm supporting my students, all of my students, I'm developing an inclusive collection. I'm trying to create a welcoming space for all my students. But I don't think that's enough. I don't think I'm doing enough just by having an inclusive collection and appreciating and supporting all of my students. I feel like I could do more.
And what grades are your students?
I have young fives, so they are turning 5 years old until 11.
Okay. And that's tricky with some of the, especially the younger kids, they're just learning everything at the same time. But I think that I wouldn't underestimate the importance of having inclusive materials in your collection, even young age. I think there's a lot of erasure of queer people and queer history in our public school curriculums as it is. And kids just aren't hearing about these families that exist like this or people in history. And it's harmful because people see queer folks as this other that they've never heard about. And it's this new and weird thing. But if we talked about these people who have been around all throughout history, that's really helpful. And GLSEN, for all ages, GLSEN has curricula that you can look up on their website, and you can kind of incorporate some of those things. But even for the littles, there are picture books that include queer characters. And for littles, it's very appropriate. They're not going to be including things that they couldn't handle maturity-wise. But just to have those characters exist in their world and read about them and hear about people different than them, same thing that we would do for, it's important that we include Native Americans and we include people of different races and classes and things. I think that representation piece is huge. So I think that's great. And even there's a book that I love that has been really highly contested among the library community called George by Alex Gino.
Absolutely.
Yep. And it's a story. It's adorable. It's about a trans kid who is kind of figuring things out and wants to play the lead in the school play, which is a female character, but they were born a boy. And those struggles, but there's nothing inappropriate about the book, but just the fact that it has a trans main character has seemed to cause a lot of self-censorship within the field.
Of course.
And, yep. So,
well, and this is embarrassing because our collections are transparent. Anybody can look up our collections and realize just how much we are choosing against having those in our collection. And I, in my episode on self-censorship, I think that in sometimes, you know, librarians who are trying to stay off the radar of the parent Facebook jury, oftentimes, I'm not wrong. it is swift. It is a, yes, the judicial system of Facebook and parents is swift and brutal. But the fact that we can point to copies in our public libraries somehow gives us absolution. We're like, oh, see, we can show our students where they can find them in the public library. It's just not on my shelf. And I feel the same way about the, and this is a book that doesn't seem to get the same kind of attention, but Best Man.
I loved Best Man.
And I'll be honest, it's quietly sat there on the shelf. And I thought it was an absolutely sweet book. And I think perhaps because the main character is a boy who learns that his teacher is dating his uncle. A male teacher is dating his uncle. And I think it is possible the reason why people don't object so strongly, because it isn't the child who is trans or gay. It's the secondary characters in the story. But that was something I thought about. You have a great list on slide 16. The first item you mentioned on slide 16 was, you know, calling students by their pronouns or the name they have asked to be used, as well as encouraging other staff to do the same. So can you, have you had students specifically say to you, I know my name is this, but I'd rather you have me call something else?
You know, typically, I've actually started a lot of the conversations. I also have run our GSA program, so the kids were pretty comfortable with me, or we'd talk about things in GSA, so they would tell me. But I think part of it is getting comfortable, especially, it's especially low risk for straight cis teachers to, when you're introducing yourself to the class at the beginning of the year, like say, I'm Mrs. Smith and I use she, her pronouns, and just start to normalize that. Because if you're not familiar with the pronouns, basically when we talked about someone's gender identity, people want to use the pronouns that match their gender identity. And some people are non-binary, so they would use they, them pronouns because they don't identify with either. But it can be very damaging. The research shows that if someone expresses their pronouns that they use and they're not used, or if someone continues to use what's called their dead name, that can be very damaging. You're not honoring who that person is. So I will ask students, oftentimes I'll just say, what pronouns do you use? And sometimes they're like, what does that even mean? So, because they don't know. But I really am impressed just from growing up. I graduated from high school in 2005, and it was so different growing up bisexual or gay back then. And they're so self-aware now. Like, they were like just so cute. They would make like bath bombs with the colors of like the lesbian flag on them, or they would like, they're just so awesome. So they're a lot more aware. They have Instagram, they have social media, so they're just learning a lot more about these terms, and we're developing a lot more language to describe how these kids identify. So I digress.
I sense that because I'll tell you what, I teach in the same district I grew up in, and I am very grateful that my own children are growing up now when they can go to GSA meetings as allies, and they can go and have students who, classmates of theirs who identify as they, them, and they do have a dead name. And my sons corrected me when I referred to one of their friends and said, no, actually, they call themselves, and gave me a new name. And I respect that, and I want to be supportive of that. Meanwhile, I'm also very aware that the parents may not recognize this decision made by the student. And we're going to get to that when we talk about the email you put out about library notices and, and student privacy. And so I noticed you mentioned also to include your pronouns in your email signature to help normalize this in the school culture. And I see it, I think where I see it a lot is in Twitter. I see that in a lot of Twitter profiles, people include their pronouns and mention it when they are in quite a few of the podcasts I listen to. I noticed you mentioned advocating for gender neutral bathrooms. And this is something I feel that, schools are in different places when it comes to, giving students that kind of, that the respect that they should have if they just want to use the toilet, they shouldn't have to go through this ordeal. I know when I went to ISTE, they had gender neutral bathrooms. And I always am pleased to see when organizations set the standard and make sure that people, you know, feel like, but those are adults and, you know, these are children. And for some reason, we don't afford them the same type of treatment as we would in a workplace.
Right. And I should note, too, when I say things like, you know, it's getting so much better, I do think there's been a lot of progress for like gays and lesbians and bisexuals. But I do think that there is more of a safety issue when we're talking about people that don't fit into that binary. So a lot of trans and non-binary folks, and one place is the bathroom that can be really hard. And I've heard things from my trans friends about people yelling at them, being like, you're going in the wrong bathroom, or and just like feeling very anxious. Or like we had a student who wrote a letter to our principal at the high school a few years ago that they would just not eat or drink anything at school because they didn't want to deal with the bathroom issue. And they would wait until they got home.
Well, and how can you focus on school when something as fundamental as using the toilet has become an issue? Well, we've already talked a little bit about making presumptions about gender based on appearance. We've talked a little bit about dividing classes up by gender. I do like your suggestions of referring to students as folks or friends, y'all. I don't know if I could pull off a convincing y'all. Hey y'all. Folks and friends are, and I've had heard friends just use students, but that seems a little stiff.
I call them humans sometimes and they giggle about it. Like my fifth graders.
Humans. Mm-hmm. No, do you know what? I'm going to try that tomorrow because I'm telling you, I think my students would actually perk up. They would be like, what? She called us humans. Well, you're not wrong. Yes, you are humans. And finally, you said number 7, you will mess up, apologize, and move on. And I think that you're absolutely right. You gave a great deal of information on what we can do in the library. And I really can't emphasize this enough. I mean, you know, for me, building an inclusive collection just doesn't seem like I'm doing this justice. I want to specifically ask about intellectual freedom and having that strong collection development policy and reconsideration policy in place. Were you part of revising yours or putting it in place, or Did you get to a school that had one already?
My school district had one already, and it's pretty, it's strong. I've looked through, and I linked on here, so you'll see these in the show notes as well, but there are resources through ALA that will walk you through having that collection development policy and what to do if there is someone contesting one of your books and the reconsideration policy. That being said, I think that it's really important to remember and make sure that all of your staff is educated on this, like your library aides, if you have them, or other administrators, because a lot of times parents will go right over your head and go to an administrator.
So all I think too that often. It's, yes.
Yeah. I think often. It's really important to have these conversations ahead of time with your administrators. For example, I put together a Transgender Awareness Week display And I just kind of gave my administrator a heads up that this was going to happen and, you know, talk to me if you get any pushback, but that might happen, but I think it's important and here's why. And luckily she was very supportive. But I think just like having those administrators on your side and having them understand that they can't, because I've had administrators just pull a book and keep it in their office. And I'm like, nope.
I have too.
So that, and we haven't had anything officially contested, but we had a parent call that was upset at our fifth and sixth grade building. There was a series where it was about four friends and one of the friends had two moms. And so she told my library assistant she didn't want her student reading anything with gay characters in it. So what that turned into, like, well, we can't decide what your child can read, but that's a conversation that you can have with her. We're not marking all of our books that have gay characters in them or queer characters in them. Having that, knowing it, having that in your back pocket, and forming that committee, just kind of having your staff aware, can be very good in your favor.
Well, and we did mention self-censorship, and I think that this is one that we're all going to wrestle with, because we all serve different communities, and you know, depending on the kind of support we have with our administration, I think that self-censorship is something that we are all going to come to terms with. I do feel a small twinge of rebellion when I read Todd Parr's family book, because it is just about the most wonderful book, because it imagines all configurations of families and affirms the importance of the loving family taking any shape it does as being wonderful. And I love this book for many reasons, but when I read it to my students, not a single student bats an eyelash at anything I have to say. And I think that there isn't anything wrong with seeing the sort of encouraging the message of acceptance when we do even the most introductory of story times to our youngest students. Because if we're not making a big deal out of it, they will interpret our story time as being completely, absolutely ordinary. And Mrs. Herman's reading this story and I like it, and maybe I'll take it home and share it with my family. You mentioned here not using the rainbow sticker, not to other these books.
Yeah, that comes up a lot.
Would you speak a little to that? Because I think that on the one hand, we are all about access and enabling our students to find the books they want to read. So could you explain to us why that can be very counterproductive in, albeit well-intentioned, could be actually very counterproductive to our students?
Yeah, I see this come up a lot in the online forums and things and Future Ready Librarians. And I personally feel that if you're labeling a book with a rainbow sticker and you have a kid who is questioning their gender identity, they are not going to want to carry that around and be labeled with that. Especially middle school and high school are really hard to begin with. So that, and you could be potentially deterring a student from learning something or relating to a character in a book that they would have otherwise picked up had they been able to do it discreetly. So I would not make a section. I would definitely do displays so that the kids see them when they're coming in. And there's a whole list from GLSEN of different holidays and things that you can celebrate with them. But for the stickers, I would also recommend putting together a resource list or a collection in Destiny Collections if you use that. And then have that as an option when students are coming into the library, or have it as a list sitting out so they can go through it if they want to. But I think that that physically marking them as something, I think, creates more negative than
well, and some of this speaks to relationship building, because as you work with students, they'll feel more comfortable in sharing with you. We really do serve our students better if we can build those relationships and be able to give them the kinds of materials we think they would find really supportive to help them. Any resources you happen to find between now and this weekend, by all means, let's embed them in our show notes, and I'll make sure that the show notes that get published on Sunday have resources that would give teachers, school librarians, more information from GLSEN and obviously your presentation. I really am glad that you included GLSEN, which is the Gay, Lesbian, and Straight Education Network. And there were some strategies that was provided, and the Safe Space Kit is free to download, which I noticed as well. And I do really like these guidelines that have been suggested. First of all, including in your library rules about respect, and posting those in a place where everybody sees them when they walk in the door. Mm-hmm. The intervening when you are witnessing bullying and name calling, unfortunately, library checkout tends to be very casual, and kids sometimes don't realize adults are listening. And they might revert back to what we would consider to be recess behavior or hallway behavior. And unfortunately, I've overheard plenty of conversations which were unkind or thoughtless and really would make somebody feel very much attacked.
Yes, and I think it's really important for the kid who's saying that, and even though they may not attach the meaning to it, the kids around them hear that. And they can internalize it. So I think that it's so valuable for them to hear an adult intervene and say, you know what, that's not okay to say, and here's why, point out those things, whether it's about race or gender identity or any of those things.
Yeah. Well, I've made sure at the elementary level, I include several lessons on bullying and at each of the grade levels, because this is something that students have the responsibility to stand up for individuals when they see this happen, and hopefully that message is something that the kids take with them. This is one recommendation: to display books and hang posters which represent diversity, both in the representation as well as, say, family configuration. Also, the having LGBT related content, this is, do you have any of these resources on the school resource page? Or I'll be honest, I don't, not at the elementary school level.
And you know what? I think that's really your discretion. I think having them in there and displaying them is perfectly fine, as long as the kids have access to books where you're seeing different people being represented. I don't think it can hurt to make a collection and have it displayed somewhere for kids that are looking for it. For me, middle school is really where a lot of that comes into play. But I will say that my trans friends tell me, I've known since I was 3 that I was trans. So I think just make them available, and don't be afraid to read them to the whole class. I think that's something that can be kind of scary, because you're worried that they're going to go home and tell their parents, and their parents will call. But it's, I mean this with so much love, but for the librarians out there, it's not about you, and you have protections in place with your job. This being a librarian is revolutionary. We know this, throughout history. So be ready to go to bat for these kids, because they need these things to be normalized for them throughout, from the youngest ages all the way up. And I feel very strongly about that.
Right. Our collection is not just about windows and letting kids, the windows, it's also the mirrors. And so having a collection that gives students that kind of affirmation when they read a book, that they're able to see themselves in the library. You mentioned celebrating throughout the year different celebratory weeks and I will say, I do sense that June, we're still in school in June. I've seen students wearing plenty of rainbows at the elementary level, and my rainbow stays on my badge all year long. But I sense, at least, that in the schools that that Pride and have, you know, Pride Month does get a certain amount of acceptance because it is becoming so more widely accepted in the general population, having Pride marches. And but I did, I will say, I have some students that I saw last June, and I noticed they were wearing rainbows in their hair and rainbows on. You know, and on their shirts. And I said, "Oh, happy Pride." And they're like, "Happy Pride, Mrs. Herman." I was like, "That's fantastic." So, I did want to mention this question that you posted on our listserv, right before Thanksgiving. And you said, if I could quote, please, "Hi all, for those who are in middle school and high school settings, I'm wondering where the line is on protecting a student's privacy versus getting books back. Do you send notices home to the parents? My concern is LGBT plus students with materials about that topic for whom it might not be safe for their parents to know, or other sensitive issues with parents that students should be allowed to seek information about. I do not want to cause an unsafe situation, but I also need to get my books back. And having parents aware of missing books does help them get them back. What do you do in your middle schools and high schools?" And I really want to hear, did you get any sort of feedback that you could work with in terms of, you know, a strategy that would not endanger or threaten your students at when they go home with these overdue notices?
Yeah, so I got quite a few responses. There was a great conversation. I love MAME's listserv. It's one of the best things about MAME. So a lot of librarians were saying that they will send an email to the student that includes the title of the book, because we all know we have those students that are like, "I didn't check that out. I don't know. What is it?" So you got to include it to the student. But when it comes to, because you know, a lot of librarians will like print a list for the teacher and be like, "Hunt these down." And then you don't want the teacher to be like listing them off to the whole class. And even if it's not a sensitive topic, they deserve to have their privacy protected. That's part of the ALA Bill of Rights. So when it's coming to distributing to teachers or to parents, there is and if you're using Destiny, I'm sure in whatever system you're using, there's an option you can uncheck title as part of your overdue notice that you're producing. So that's what we started doing in my district now, or at least at my middle school. I'm working on it. So the parent gets the notice that there's a book out, and then they can go to the kid and be like, "Where's your book?" But that way we're not necessarily giving them the title. And I spoke with my administrators about it, and they were supportive about it. The only issue, and I couldn't get a straight answer from anyone about this, is that if a parent really comes back and pushes, I know some librarians were saying that they will just say, "No, that's part of our library's policy. We have to protect student privacy." But it's kind of like, you know, for a minor in a doctor's office, they have to talk to the parent about it. So I think if a parent really came after and pushed, I couldn't find any legal backing. So if anyone knows of anything, I would love to hear it. I'm still kind of looking. But I think just as a general policy that we don't give that out up front, and, you know, have a conversation with the kid. Like, if you can you find this book? Can we work something out if you're concerned about the parent knowing? So.
Right. Well, and I think that ultimately, you know, our students know that we support them. And, you know, yes, we do need the book to come back. And we also don't want to jeopardize their home situation. And so I have noticed that a lot of times when kids are checking out books, I will have communications with the teachers, because the teachers will see these kids every day and can give me some direction about especially with students I'm just getting to know, and finding out, you know, I have been comfortable asking these teachers, "Can you tell me, is this kid growing up in a house that is supportive of them? Is this child being raised by parents who, you know, are supportive of this child?" Can I ask you, you've given us a lot to think about. If you happen to encounter any more resources, to please go ahead and to let me know. I'm going to put some more resources on the show notes. Could you just give us an idea of if we could follow you on social media, if you have, any concluding, you've given us a lot of advice. I don't I think this is one of those episodes I'm going to be thinking about for a long time.
Thank you. I know, I feel like there's still so much more I could say too. One thing I want to make sure that I say before
please
we
do.
End too, there is a great series of trainings being offered through the Michigan Department of Ed currently called A Silent Crisis, Creating Safe and Supportive Schools for LGBTQ Students. So there's like there's a 101 course and a 201 course, and luckily my district is sending me, which I really appreciate. I have the list of the different trainings, but I'll put the contact person's name in the show notes if anyone's interested in joining in some of those trainings. But one of the things that we talked about was that, one of the most effective things for creating a safe school environment is having a GSA. So if you don't have one at your school, I would recommend, like, if you feel comfortable, and you don't have to be queer to lead one, you can be an ally and you can find, there's so many resources out there. Or if you have a teacher that would be interested, and you can just offer the library space for that. It doesn't have to meet every day. Doesn't have to have a huge plan to it, but just a space where the students can come and be safe if they want to talk. And when I've run it before, my students were very passionate, where they took the lead and they planned activities that they would do, and we brainstormed how to self-care and just all kinds of things, and they were incredible. So just having that out there, even if it's not well attended, if it's not well attended, that might mean that the kids are feeling safe and they don't feel like they need that. But just having it as an option and knowing it's in the school and knowing that there are adults in the school that support that makes a huge difference.
No, I agree. I know I've talked to several librarians who not only host the meetings but also sponsor them as well. And I think that really does set the example for everyone. And I think the other thing about having librarians as sponsors of this group is because we work with all students in all grades, it does give students there's a comfort there, because when a GSA, advisor is a teacher that you've never had before, I'm thinking like at the middle school or high school, this might be a teacher you don't know. On the other hand, a school librarian knows all the students. And mm-hmm. So you have that advantage, and hopefully being able to build those relationships. And I imagine sort of it's the more the merrier. As students feel comfortable coming to GSA, they can bring their friends. They can, there's sort of strength in numbers. They sort of realize this is a place where they can go and feel supported.
Yeah, and it helps you build those relationships with the kids, and they'll see that you're honoring their pronouns and their identities, and just being that empathetic listener that they might not have at home can make a huge difference for a kid.
So. Sure. Oh, well, I can't thank you enough. I this is a very busy time of the year, and I'll be honest, this is the last episode of 2019. And I really want to thank you for giving us all of this information to think about, because I think starting in 2020, one of our goals is to be more supportive of our students and to improve our library programs so that all of them feel welcome and supported. So I thank you so much for joining me. I hope you have a great evening and a great holiday.
Thank you so much for the platform. I really appreciate it.
I am so grateful to Kelly for sharing her perspective and her resources with all of us, and for making this episode so meaningful. You can follow Kelly on Twitter at @KBMediaTech. Be sure to also visit our show notes, which are rather extensive and full of great resources for all grade levels. I included a link to Kelly's presentation, Queer Eye for the Library. Be sure that you go through all of the different slides. It really was a great presentation that she gave this past October. Kelly also shared with me a resource which is available to Michigan educators if you happen to live in the neighborhood. And this is a program which is titled A Silent Crisis, and it is training which is available across the state of Michigan during 2019 to 2020, and the schedule is available in the show notes. I also wanted to include some GLSEN resources. The website is terrific. It's got great resources for anyone, whether you are already working on creating these safe spaces for your students in your school library, or you want to get started and you're not quite sure where to go. GLSEN has some great resources for you, including a link I have in the show notes titled Library as a Safe Space, Librarian as Ally. Also, activities, K-12 lesson plans and program materials, a 2019-2020 school calendar. And I wanted to also make sure Kelly highly recommended ALA's Rainbow Roundtable, and I included a link to that in the show notes, as well as We Need Diverse Books, which really does a great job of recommending titles to promote diversity as well as support our LGBTQ plus students. I would like to thank you for listening today. As I mentioned, I will be taking a break to enjoy the holidays with my family. A very happy new year to everyone, and I look forward to 2020 and more episodes to come. Our next episode will be posted during the first week of the new year. I hope you will tune in.